Innovation in Conversation, proudly brought to you by AFGRI, Fort Knox, Hinterland, Monsanto, Nedbank, NWK, and Sendex. Every now and then, a man's mind is stretched by a new idea or sensation and never shrinks back to its former dimensions. Development is about transforming the lives of people, not just transforming economies.
Good day and welcome to Nation in Conversation with me, Theo Foster. Today's discussion revolves around technological integration in the agricultural sector and the significant impact this has made on food production. You can follow us on Twitter at NationConverse or visit the website nationinconversation.co.za. Joining me in the studio today is Arno van Vieren, Manager Agricultural Management Services NWK, and Pieter Geldnys, Director Institute for Technology Strategy and Innovation, Potchefstroom Business School, Northwest University. I want to start with you, Arno. The buzzword is currently that everybody uses when they talk about agriculture, the use of technology in agriculture, is precision farming. What is precision farming?
So precision farming is doing the stuff that you do on the farm, doing that more precise. So it's a process where measurements are taking place in order to lower your inputs and enhance your outputs with sustainability as the end result. So as an example, you would see that a farmer measures small managerial areas on the farm individually and managing the inputs and outputs on that small area more intensely than was the case a few years ago where a whole field or a whole farm was managed as a unit.
What's the aim of measuring this information?
The main aim of measuring is to gain information. That information is used for decisions that you have to make in terms of what is the products you have to apply, what are the applications you have to do. For instance, you would in the remote sensing, for instance, you will have the ability to look at pest infestations or disease infestations and see that from remote sensing applications. And then you can identify the problem and go in and address that problem on the area that is infested and not on a total field.
On that specific area.
In that specific area.
And the benefit there is not only cost, but it's also more efficient farming.
When a smaller area is managed, it is possible to lower the cost of inputs that you are applying, and you will also be in a position to only manage that area that needs to be addressed and not the total area that you normally have to address. It's a more efficient process and it's really taking us some ways in putting food on the table that is safer for the consumer.
Peter, key to this is information. What is the concept big data? Because I think this has to do with collating information and utilizing that information to your benefit. This principle of big data, does that link to this?
Yes, it does. Big data is the gathering of all types of information, be it human created information or even data created by machines. The importance is that we gather all this information and we try to recognize certain patterns within the data that is not evident in daily lives. So big data is looking for the hidden patterns that can help us to generate and create more value that wasn't possible before. So big data's got a wide field, but the true value of big data is that once we recognize these patterns, that we can share this information with the relevant agents within the network so they can react and therefore create more value in the ecosystem than was possible before. So huge benefit if we can capture data and make it available for those that need it.
A question that I sometimes come across is in this respect, if it's my farm and my information, who owns that information? To what extent should somebody own that?
Well, yes, you can claim certain information if you pay for the gathering of it, but the real value of information is how we share it. It's this interaction between different farmers. For example, if you determine that a certain disease has broken out in your crop, you want to share that with everyone around you so they can react in a timely fashion. It's really about the sharing of information where the sharing economy or big data truly get its value. There's little value in trying to hoard the information for yourself. The real value is in sharing information and helping others to use that information so it can not only benefit you, but benefit those around you.
We now focus on the agriculture sector, but the application is far wider than agriculture.
Yes, it is. We are seeing wonderful new business models emerging. We call it the sharing economy. We all know about Airbnb and Uber that allows you to leverage agents in the market that have spare capacity and make it available for those that are looking for that specific need.
And unlike to that, the sharing information.
Correct. And we can use the same thing in agriculture. There's no reason why you have to buy a tractor. You buy timeshare in a tractor. And the tractor can come and farm and harvest on your field, and it can drive throughout the day or throughout the night. In the next 2 or 3 years, we might even have robot tractors doing that. And so the idea of owning something is giving away to an environment where you have access to it when you need it. The sharing economy goes further than that. The entire value chain from you taking produce to the market now becomes open to the sharing economy, enabling us to be far more efficient than we were in the past.
Arnu, but this also puts additional responsibility and pressure on the agriculture company. Your client is going to look different. He's going to have different expectations. How do you position an agricultural company to keep on servicing this client base?
I think an agricultural company will have to restructure to a certain sense because the client base is now changing. The demand coming from the client base is different than it was a few years ago. And with all this information going around and being available, the producer will be in a position to demand that they be serviced by the input suppliers, which includes the agribusinesses, to really come into play with the products and the services that they need. And I think this is going to really escalate to a great sense in future, where the producer will expect the input supplier to be there for them.
And they will have to need to have the knowledge and technology available.
Yes, of course. A lot of the technology that we see nowadays is imported from overseas, which makes the input supplier locally only an input supplier. It's only an agent for the technology that comes in from overseas. So we will have to see development in service possibilities and the knowledge around that, and also the product service of the products themselves. You will have to see that.
After the break, we're going to look at some interesting technology. Stay with us. Welcome back to Nation in Conversation. We've ambushed Arnu here, Pieter. Explain, what is that?
Well, what Arnu has got on is the Samsung version of Oculus Rift. It's a technology that allows you to be submerged into a virtual world. Now, remember that the difference between a virtual reality and normal reality is the amount of data that you receive in terms of your eyes and your ears. And it's really as simple as that. So what Arnu
just to explain, so if you can provide enough data to me, you can actually create a reality that stimulates all my senses.
That's indistinguishable from what you normally see in front of you. And he's very close to that. I think he's about 85% there. A very high quality screen allowing him to be submerged into a movie. So right now, he is within a movie and he can look at the entire environment around him on a 360-degree angle. And, well, let Anu explain.
It's driven by your cell phone.
It's driven by your cell phone. So Anu, where are you right now?
Yes, currently I'm standing on the top of a building within a city and a lot of crowds going around. I've got the feeling to duck when the crowds come my way. But it's really stunning because you've got this 3D image with depth and height and everything is so real.
So on what floor are you right now, Arnu, when you take a look down at the ground level?
Yeah, it must be about 100 stories high. And it feels as if you're standing on the edge of this building. It's open space all around with not much around you to keep you safe.
Well, let's Arnu, remove that, and I want to talk about the applications of this.
The applications of this is huge. You can, for example, design your house. Thank you, Arnu. I really appreciate that. But you can design a house, and then you can put those augmented reality helmet or that virtual reality helmet on, and you can experience what it is inside the house.
So you can put that on, and you can walk into your
Correct.
House.
Correct. And you can experience the house through different seasons, at time of the day. You can then change the house based on your personal preferences. So the idea that an architect comes and gives you a three-dimensional drawing or gives you a little 3D model, those days are over. You are going to live inside your house and experience it.
While you design it.
And you can co-design it. So it's all about co-designing. You as a agent becoming part of the decision-making environment. But the applications are huge. Think of sport events. And you can go to a sport event and you can put one of these on inside the stadium. And you will then switch onto a camera on the other side of the stadium and you'll be able to experience what's happening in front of your very eyes. So you can switch between 7 or 8 cameras. You can sit at home and you can put one of these helmets on and you can have a full 360-degree view of the world around you. In the future, you are going to go to a rugby match and you're going to put on the helmet, and in some instances, you won't be able to recall if what you saw was through a camera or through your own eyes. That's where we're heading. And I believe by 2020 in Japan that this technology will be available.
If we get back to a minute to the agriculture industry that we are focusing on, this type of technology, if you put that, combine that with let's say a drone, where can that take us?
Well, you very soon you'll be able to put that on and you'll be able to influence the tracking of a camera on a drone. So you'll be able to take a look around you, and as you change the focus of your view, the camera on the drone will change as well. So it becomes very simple, very easy to take a look at what's happening around you. For security, looking at where your livestock is, looking at the growth of maize, you can utilize that for a number of instances. But it becomes not only a cool toy, it becomes a very important part of managing a large farm.
Arnu, if we just go back a minute to the usage of drones on farms. Would you say that will form part of a big commercial farm in the future?
Yes, I think drone technology will be part and parcel of the daily operations on a big farm in future. Just for the reasons that I think that Peter also touched on, especially say in game farming where the animals are scared easily, drone technology is already being used to count the stock and to even with sensors looking if some of the stock are actually diseased. Are they
measuring the temperature and the
measuring
behavior?
Temperature. So drones gives you the ability to put a number of different sensors into that drone with different abilities in what they measure. So you can do a normal color sensor with red, yellow, blue bandwidths, or you can go NDVI where you use near-infrared sensors, and that gives you a lot of ability. And I think in future drones and remote sensing on the farm is going to be part and parcel of what's being done daily on
and it'll
farm.
Be security also plays a big role in that.
Definitely. Drones are already used for security purposes to patrol fences and oil pipelines and the likes. And with the different drone ability that you've got nowadays, you can basically do anything with drones. The army applications, military applications, for instance, they even use drones that are 5 by 10 centimeters big, which you can carry on your person, and that gives you ability to launch a drone, have a look around, and come back. And these applications are now getting affordable. It's easy to operate. The software that supports the drones are really easy to use. So the more advanced drone applications will probably be done by companies doing services for farmers.
security and technology. South Africa has always been part of the security technology industry, but we're actually playing in some aspects a leading role.
We are. I'm aware of an app called T-Trumpet, which will be launching soon. They've got a subset on it called Shout, and it's really interesting what they've done. They give you the capability to, for example, take a picture of something that looks suspicious. And everyone that's interested in that neighborhood in security would immediately find it. And if anyone else says, yes, I saw it as well, here's another picture, you can then start sharing your suspicions. But it goes further. It doesn't over inundate you with information. You only follow certain links that's of interest to you. You can, for example, if you have 5 or 6 security cameras at your house and 1 or 2 of them look out on the street, on this app, you can then identify what those 2 cameras are. The rest are private. You only share the 2 that look out on the street, and now everyone's personal cameras now become part of a neighborhood watch of cameras, and you can then access it. So if someone breaks in at one place, you can track where these individuals have gone after the break-in, do identification on their vehicles or on their person. You even spoke in a previous conversation about face recognition on some of these cameras. So wonderful capabilities. But it's all about us in the sharing economy converging around a certain idea or identity and using that platform to share the information for the betterment of society and our safety.
And the key is to share that information. Otherwise,
correct,
this is not possible.
Correct. The key thing is specifically on farms is that if you're in a dangerous situation, you don't have time to open up an app and click a button. We are seeing technologies where your smart watches allow that. You click a button, you press a button, and everyone knows that you're in danger. And they know exactly what's happening. It starts recording the voice around you. You can then detect if there's true danger or not. Wonderful technologies that'll help us because security is a very important part of our future in agriculture.
Nation in Conversation will be back after the break. Welcome back to Nation in Conversation. Arno, we've talked about technology. We've talked about precision farming, the use of drones. If I look at what we've said and I look at the technological advances that we're continuously seeing, the farmer in 5, 10 or 15 years from now and the agriculture company supporting the farmer in 5, 10 or 15 years from now, what will be the demands on the farmer and his agriculture company?
Yes, nowadays the farmers that come onto the farms are in a position that they are computer literate, very computer literate. They've got a big demand to have access to information, that information that is needed to take daily decisions, to make those decisions on an informed basis. And this demand is growing. And as new farmers come into play with this demand, the input supplier, the agribusiness, will have to be in a position to service that farmer. So in 5 to 10 years' time from now, I would say we are going to see a big growth in what we will have to supply from agribusiness side, input supply side, in terms of technology and precision farming applications, normal applications that you can run on a cell phone or a smartphone, to give this farmer access to the information needed to do absolute daily short-term decisions. We are currently in a space where a farmer can sit in a tractor and get basic important decision-making information via a cell phone. This is something that was not there 5 years ago. We did not have that. So with the advances that we're seeing now, in the next 5 to 10 years, I think the developments are going to be stunning. It's going to be very important to have that, and the input supplier will have to be in that space to provide that service.
Peter, technology? Where do you see the main trends? I know it's very difficult to look at the future. We sometimes get it wrong. But if you look at the main trends in agriculture, what are you seeing?
Well, let's frame that within the major mega trends that we are seeing around the world. We are seeing unequal population growth, the flattening of population in some of the developed countries, huge increase in population, specifically in Africa. So that's the one key trend. We're looking at scarcity of resources, water, for example. We're also taking a look at the Anthropocene, where we become the authors of our own civilization's demise because we don't respect the environment. These are the major trends, and within those major trends, we can use technology to ensure that we can harness the future to a better extent. Questions will be asked. Should we, if we look at the protein creation, currently it's rudimentary, we give grain to cattle and we get protein from that. That means for 10 kilograms of grain, we can harvest 1 kilogram of protein. Wouldn't it be better to use that grain and feed insects and then get 7 or 8 kilograms of protein, mix that up, and on a 3D printer, we can print a nice little hamburger. I don't know if we should can call it a hamburger. Yes, they've done it already. They say it doesn't taste very good, but maybe they can work on that in an environment of constrained resources.
The one element is technology, but people need to adapt to that.
That's right, and that's the scary part. We as society very slowly adapt to the possibilities of a technology. It normally takes about 20 years after the introduction of a technology before society is even prepared to consider changing their ways. So there are a number of things that would limit our use of technology. We can take a look at genetic engineering in order to look at certain cattle strains that emit less CO2 into the atmosphere. It's already been done. Will people be prepared to eat meat that come from cows with a genetic change in terms of their CO2 emission? There's a variety of key questions. However, within these major mega trends, in some instances, we're not going to have a choice. And when there's pressure, we normally see people react accordingly. And then the future becomes a whole new ballgame.
He talked about people reacting differently. In the agriculture spectrum, that's the consumer. The consumer will place certain demands on the food chain. And right at the end or the beginning of the food chain is the primary producer, the farmer. Agriculture company, but in the end, the consumer pulls this food chain in a specific direction. To what extent will that influence what is going to happen on the farm?
Yes, I think in future, the demand from the consumer will be the driver behind production. So the producer will have to be in a position to produce what the consumer wants. And that is probably going to be safer food with traceability, knowing where it comes from, produced on a acceptable basis for the animal and the broader population. And then, of course, I think we've talked about the availability of water and the impact we have on our environment. Those issues are going to be the bigger issues in consumer pricing and ability to buy and willingness to use products. I think we're going to be in a position where the consumer is going to dictate what the producer has to produce.
And that consumer can have specific demands, but we also have the demand for food security, for basic food on scale. How are we going to manage those two?
We are currently in a position where resources are getting so scarce. We've got water scarcity, we've got scarcity of land availability, and we're sitting with a lot of land not being utilized optimally. This puts a lot of pressure on the total volume of food being produced. So there's only one way to get through this, and this is to optimize what is produced. We will have to use the resources we have optimally and make sure that we produce the biggest portion of food on a very small portion of land. We don't have new land that comes available. What we have is what we have to use. And I think there's going to be a lot of demand on land in future as well.
Peter, are technology going to save us from these challenges? If you look at the urbanization of the population, the fact that the world population is bigger, that resources are limited, is the answer in technology?
As a technocrat, I'd love to say yes, but in the end, the adoption of technology by the larger society that would give you the answer. We also believe that different societies will adopt different technologies based on where they come from. But there is huge advances in genetics, where we have far better yield on crops. That is a huge advantage. There is definite genetic manipulation of livestock. Is the society ready for that yet? We might have to get used to it if the scarce resources that Arno's speaking about is coming to fruition.
Technology will be part of the future and will be part of the solution.
Yes, it will be.
Thank you very much. You can follow us on Twitter at Nation Converse or visit our website, nationinconversation.co.za. From me, Theo Foster, good day.
Nation in Conversation, proudly brought to you by AFGRI, Fort Knox, Interlac, Monsanto, Nedbank, NWK, and Sendes.
The world is changing today. The world is changing in every way. Let's stand together, put our hands together, join hands forever. We're making it better. No matter